The coronavirus pandemic will cause the worst global economic fallout since the Great Depression.
And the pandemic has been particularly devastating for indigenous people across Latin America.
In all of these three lockdowns, India has lost more than 18.55 lakh crore.
The country has started preparing for a tough few years ahead after the finance minister Tito Mboweni laid down South Africa's tough financial path yesterday.
But we are just not generating enough revenue from tax.
Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on your part of the world. Thank you so much for joining us today for this very important look at the state of tax justice in 2020 and in the time of COVID-19. My name is Nana Amasarfo. I'm a contributing editor with TaxNotes International, and I'll be moderating today's event. We have a full program packed with speakers and video presentations and some very distinguished panelists who are going to break down some of the findings in today's report. And then after that, we will have a question and answer session. So if you have any questions, please enter them in the Q&A box below, and we will pull them up for the Q&A session a bit later. Also, I wanted to note that we are streaming today's presentation in 5 different languages, in Arabic, in English, in French, in Spanish, and Portuguese. So please select your preferred choice at the interpretation button below. With that said, first up, we'll be hearing from philanthropist and civil society activist Jafar Shalchi. Jafar is the founder of the Human Act Foundation, and he has some pretty powerful remarks to share on what fair taxation should look like. So with that, we'll start the video.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jafar Shalchi. I am a multimillionaire, and I should be taxed more. I'm honored to have been invited to say a few words on tax justice in the time of COVID. The report shows myriad injustice in our tax systems. It highlights how countries are losing more than $427 billion in tax each year to international corporate tax abuse and private tax evasion. I know that a fair tax system means that people like me and my wealthy friends will pay more. And we should. I was born in Tehran, Iran, in 1961. When I was 9 years old, I came to Copenhagen with my mother and my 4 siblings. Thanks to the Danish welfare system and to the Danish tax system, I was fortunate to receive free education and free healthcare. I became an engineer, then a real estate entrepreneur, and eventually made a multi-million fortune. I became a philanthropist, but I learned too that philanthropy, taught worthwhile, cannot bring a world where all can thrive. Tax can. The State of Tax Justice report being launched today calls on governments to take 3 actions. 1, introduce an excess profit tax. 2, introduce a wealth tax. And 3, establish a UN tax convention. All are smart and will help improve our world. Fair taxation will make the market work better. We'll be more safe. It will enable more people to grow strong businesses. For 5 years, Human Act has, together with strategic partners, been advocating for a 1% world tax to finance health, education, infrastructure, and tackling climate change. The Millionaires for Humanity, led aside by my wife and I, and by another 110 millionaires from 13 countries, in July asked our respective governments to raise taxes on people like us to contribute to the consequences of the COVID-19 crisis. As we noted, tax us. Congratulations on this report, on this convening, and all the work all of you to do for a more just world. We can move humanity together. Thank you.
Thank you for those great remarks, Jafar. Next, we will hear some welcoming remarks from Alex Cobham. Alex is the CEO of the Tax Justice Network, and he is an economist whose research includes inequality and illicit financial flows, as well as corporate tax evasion and avoidance. And Alex is going to share with us some of the top lines from today's report.
Thank you, Nana, and thank you all for joining us. This has been a long process. We've wanted to do this kind of report for years, and now finally we have the data that means we can. The Tax Justice Network is an independent international network of experts, economists, lawyers, accountants, political scientists, activists. We were set up formally in 2003, and we've been working as part of a global movement ever since. We're delighted that this report and all the work behind it has been done in partnership with the Global Alliance for Tax Justice Network, which is the umbrella body for mass mobilization organizations in this space, and with the Global Union Federation Public Services International, which includes, of course, both health workers and tax workers. And what this report this year reveals is that globally, the losses to international corporate and individual tax abuse amount to some $427 billion. And this, in fact, is an extremely cautious estimate, but that is enough to pay for one nurse's annual salary every second. Every second. There's another one. Think of the nurses we need during this pandemic. Think of the health spending that is not in place, but would be if we were able to tackle these tax abuses. Now, in fact, that $427 billion made up of $245 billion of corporate tax abuse losses and $182 billion of losses to individual tax evasion through offshore assets is the result of about $1.8 trillion in illicit financial flows underlying that. But more than that, those numbers, which we're able to break down to the country level to show which countries are suffering what level of losses, but also which countries are driving the losses for others. It's the first time we've been able to do this for about 200 countries and jurisdictions using some of the newly available data that comes from the kind of transparency measures that we've been pushing since we began. Measures for the automatic exchange of financial account information between countries, for beneficial ownership transparency, to know who's behind companies and trusts and foundations, and for country-by-country reporting from multinational companies so that we can see finally the scale of profit shifting and start to take action. Now, what we see in these numbers is that the high-income countries, the major economies, lose the most in absolute terms, but as a proportion of tax revenues and as a proportion of health budgets, it's lower income countries that see the biggest losses. In many cases, more than 50% of health budgets are accounted for by these revenue losses. There couldn't be a more urgent time for us to take action about this. Now, as you've heard from Jafar, we've called for three key measures here. In the pandemic, we need two in particular to make sure that the right people are contributing to this. An excess profits tax, first of all, so that companies like Amazon that have made such enormous profits, not through their own merits, but simply from the huge state interventions of lockdowns to protect public health, the extra money they've made from that needs to be taken back into public revenues in order to support that health spending and the other public good measures. At the same time, we need wealth taxes. The case could not be clearer. And you've heard again from Jafar, we need to use the wealth that we have, especially the highest levels of wealth, to protect public health. And we now have the data to understand the ownership patterns and the wealth inequality to enable us to do that. But these are national measures. At the global level, the crisis also lays bare the failures of global governance, the failure of the OECD to take the kind of measures necessary. That's why we've been pushing, and we're pleased to see the UN FACTI panel is now actively discussing this too, for a UN convention on tax to make sure that all countries at all income levels are fully included in the benefits of transparency, and that when we set international tax rules as a negotiation between different countries, that every country is at the table taking part in this process. Only in this way can we hope to see the state of tax justice, these huge revenue losses at the national and global level, start to come down in future years as we publish this analysis again and again, hoping to drive a conversation with the media and with policymakers until the kind of substantial progress that's urgently needed is finally made. Let me hand back to Nana. Thank you.
Alex, thank you so much for those remarks. Those figures that you mentioned are staggering, and as you'd mentioned, they really highlight the need for global cooperation in this space. So in that light, next we'll be hearing from Dereje Alemayu, and he is the executive coordinator for the Global Alliance for Tax Justice. And Dereje is going to talk about the importance of coordination and cooperation within the tax justice space, and what this new data from today's report means for advocacy work moving forward.
Dereje, you're muted.
Oh, now am I, you hear me now? Okay, thank you. No, I'm very delighted to be part of this process, firstly, because the tax justice movement should be able to bring together different constituencies, different competencies together, so that the convergence of all these movements leads us to more mass mobilization and the generation of political will to implement some of our demands. Maybe at first sight, because we have been operating with huge numbers of illicit financial law figures, the 427 billion might appear to be a low figure, but and there might be some confusion or hesitation even in some circles, but it has to be emphasized that this is about tax revenue loss. It is not about resource leakages in general. It's not about illicit financial flows or a comprehensive estimation of even tax abuse at the country level, because the data is limited to the OECD country-by-country reporting data, which captures only the companies with a threshold turnover of 750 billion. When we do our campaigns in Africa and worldwide, we are also concerned about foregone and forsaken revenue through unnecessary tax concessions given to multinationals, through the different leakages from the revenue system. So this is just to say the figure is about tax revenue loss each year. The other important thing to emphasize is the some might not agree that the effective tax rate was taken as a basis for the calculation. If a nominal tax rate was taken, the figure would come higher. But I think the most important thing is not. As you might remember, there was this European Union ruling in which the Irish government was asked to retrieve 13 billion euro of tax cheating that was done by Apple. It is not now about getting back the money which was lost last year. It is about preventing the permanent tax abuse which is happening every year. So if we have another comma before or after the figure, that might not be very important. What is very important is that the mechanisms are laid bare, that the destination of tax abuse resources is clearly stated there. So if we know the destinations, if we know the mechanisms used, why is a solution lacking? Here again, as one of the key demands from the report, we are asking for a UN tax convention in which all these issues could be raised and resolved in once and for all. OECD is a club membership country with most of the rich countries included in it. It has no mandate to set standards and make tax rules. OECD might not be claiming that, but what we are facing is those blocking a UN process always use the OECD as a pretext for their blockade, saying OECD is doing it, keep quiet. But we have seen that OECD in its own terms is not coming to any conclusion. So it is very important to have an intergovernmental process at the UN to solve it. And also to recognize it is not about development aid. It is not part of development policy. It is about the right of developing countries to have a share on the tax of the consolidated global profit of multinationals for the profit generated in their economies. It is about them benefiting from their assets, which are hidden and stashed in secrecy jurisdictions. So it is not a development policy agenda. It is a rights agenda, the right of developing countries to tax. And in this sense, we as Global Alliance for Tax Justice have endorsed the three key demands of the report: economic excess profit on profits which are being made even despite the COVID-induced crisis, introduction of wealth tax, and also, of course, the UN Tax Convention. Okay, my time is up. Just to conclude, finally, as I said at the beginning, tax justice movement can succeed only if the organizations in it with different constituencies and competencies come together. It will be very difficult for our activists to raise a similar data on their own in their different countries. So the information and the data and the policy analysis in this document will equip our activists with fresh information and to continue their campaign. So thank you very much, and really it is the beginning of a long journey, and I hope we will be more effective in coming together to have more impact and to make the tax justice movement more impactful. Thank you very much.
Deleje, thank you very much for those very insightful remarks, especially your extremely great points on the fact that it's important to be proactive instead of reactive in the face of corporate tax avoidance or evasion, and the fact that we're not talking about a development agenda here. We're talking about the right to collect tax from corporations that are doing business in jurisdictions. So now we will hear some recorded remarks from Rosa Pavanelli, and she is the General Secretary of Public Services International. So from there, we will start the video.
Every second, tax dodgers steal one nurse's salary out of our public budget and put it into their offshore pocket. Imagine 1 year's salary per second. Meanwhile, the WHO says the world needs 18 million new health workers by 2030. Imagine if our government stopped corporate tax dodging. Just in 1 year, we would be able to hire exactly twice as much. 36 million new health workers, not by 2030, but by the next year. So let's be clear. The reason frontline health workers face missing PPEs and brutal understaffing is because our government spent decades pursuing austerity and privatization while enabling corporate tax dodging. Seeing the same politicians now clapping for them is an insult. That's why we repeat, the growing public anger must be channeled into real action. We need to make corporations and the mega rich finally pay their fair share of taxes to build back better our public services. At the same time, we can't be afraid to say that tax dodging is a violent crime. When they steal from our public services, people die. COVID has reminded us of that in the most cruel way. Right now, the global economy is on life support, and the only oxygen left is public funding. Yet, for years, this public funding has been stolen by many of the same financial players who now rely on it to stay afloat. We are already hearing that public debt is becoming unsustainable and that we will need austerity to pay it back. But the wealth needed to fully fund the recovery already exists. It's our uncollected tax revenue sitting in offshore bank accounts. We don't need austerity, we need change. So to all the CEOs, billionaires, financiers out there, I have one message. If you truly care about building back better, pay your fair share of taxes. I don't mean all the taxes that you are legally subject to. We all know that you have spent millions employing accountants and lawyers to build artificial structures to make your theft look legal. I mean all the taxes you know you should be paying. And to all the politicians out there who may have been scared to stand up to them, I have one message too. If you can't find the courage now, then our democracies are in grave danger. Because people are furious and they have every right to be angry. We have every right to be angry. If you don't act now, then the theft will get even worse. Inequality will continue to skyrocket and more people will give in to the fear-mongering and false promises of authoritarian leaders. Through these months of darkness, we have seen hope. We have seen a reawakening of solidarity. We have seen a surge in support of our comrades fighting COVID despite the harrowing conditions. We have seen a reconsideration of what essential work really means. Now is the moment to do all in our power to convert this support into real change. Change that improves the lives of working people, change that ends the global tax robbery, change to rebuild our public services. We need a minimum corporate tax rate to stop the race to the bottom. We need to tax global profits, and the revenue must go to where the economy activity is. And we must tax individuals who have amassed obscene wealth that keeps growing even as people are dying and the economy is collapsing. We need public country-by-country tax reporting so we can all see what corporations are up to. We need protection for whistleblowers who expose tax abuses. We need a global tax treaty to monitor shady capital flows. And we must tax the tech giants and others who are making billions while dodging their fair share. We must hold our leaders to account and force them to act in the public interest. We must keep the focus on the real cause of so many of the world's problems. We must not let the recovery be dominated by the same corporate interests who made the crisis so much worse. As the saying goes, sunlight is the best disinfectant. The State of Tax Justice Report is a powerful new tool in our struggle to change the story, to change the game. Since I started speaking, the world has lost over 200 nurses' salaries to offshore tax avoidance. This theft must stop. There is no choice left. Never before has the need for a fairer global tax system been clearer.
Many thanks to Rosa for those really excellent remarks and powerful message on the political implications of inequality and what could happen if the current system continues unchecked. So next up, we have a short film featuring testimony from healthcare workers in Liberia and Brazil and the United Kingdom. And they will talk about the funding and staffing struggles that they regularly face, which have only grown larger due to COVID-19. So let's start that video.
So when corporations don't pay their taxes, what it does is it causes underfunding of public services, particularly in the health sector where I work. We do not have sufficient nurses on the workflow. We do not have sufficient supplies because of no funding. We also cannot get the necessary quality the health system deserves so that people are treated, and you will not even find sufficient facilities across the country.
Going into this coronavirus pandemic, the NHS was already very stretched. Every winter, we entered into an even worse winter crisis, and I know that all of us were worried, all of us working on the front lines were worried about how we were going to cope with the winter crisis in and of itself without a pandemic on top of it. And seeing what was happening, for example, in Italy, which was sort of the forewarning of what was to come, that was really terrifying for us. Italy has double the number of intensive care beds per population than we do.
A depender do número de pacientes graves que você tem numa enfermaria, exige-se que se tenha um mínimo de profissionais de enfermagem. Sabemos que hoje, na maioria dos hospitais do Brasil e em São Paulo, esse número é sempre abaixo. Então, acaba sobrecarregando aqueles que estão ali. Enfermarias que deveriam ter 3-4 enfermeiros num plantão de 12 horas, tem um enfermeiro.
So with COVID-19 spreading all across the world, it becomes very, very clear that underfunding has caused all of these serious problems for the system, the health sectors.
As a result of the NHS being inadequately funded, what we're seeing is huge pressures on staff. Currently, the most common reason for staff to be off sick is because of stress-related problems, and that stress that is arising at work. This week alone, we have 30,000 staff who are off sick.
When people go to work with so much to do, understaffing, and they have to stay longer hours on the job floor, it causes burnout. They are not able to do sufficiently well as they should do, and that helps to undermine the public services.
No Brasil, atualmente, existe uma perda em impostos no valor correspondente a 15 bilhões de dólares. Esse valor, ele corresponde a 82 bilhões de reais perdidos anualmente em impostos. Isso daria para nós hoje contemplarmos 2 milhões de salários de enfermeiros no Brasil anualmente.
African governments lose over 7 billion annually through corporate tax abuse. With that much money, we could employ over 250,000 nurses throughout Africa.
Healthcare workers were thought of as being heroes, and I don't think any of us really went into this profession to be a hero or to be venerated in any way. Being a hero means that you're putting yourself on the line, and that isn't an inherent part of the job. And I think that that really needs to be reflected in the way that the government protects us, and that has to come through funding.
Nós agradecemos, mas não é suficiente os aplausos que nos foram dados. A gente quer reconhecimento no dia a dia. A gente quer material adequado para trabalhar, a gente quer condições adequadas para trabalhar.
It's a question of how we are valuing our frontline workers, our key workers during this pandemic. Do we just clap for them, or do we reflect that in terms of a pay increase that means my nursing colleagues aren't having to use food banks?
People who are breathing this system, I like to appeal to them to look back and see 30,000 children dying annually that could be prevented if they would only pay their fair share of tax. I think it's about time that they right the wrong.
Now we will hear from two people very integral to this project. Javier Garcia Bernardo and Miroslav Polanski are data scientists with the Tax Justice Network, and they will go over the methodology backing today's report. And importantly, they will share how all of you at home can access this data. So now we will turn to the presentation.
Hello, everyone. My name is Javier Garcia Bernardo, and together with my colleague Miroslav Polanski, we're going to give you a small overview of the methodology and how to access the data of the State of Tax Justice report. So the main advancement that we did in this report is the new estimate of tax revenue losses. And we estimate the tax revenue losses in two different channels. The first one is the corporate tax abuse, so tax revenue losses due to profit shifting by multinational corporations. And the second channel is private tax abuse, so offshore wealth, mainly of individuals. And we do this at the country level for as many countries as possible, over 200. And for many countries, this is the first time ever that we are able to estimate tax revenue losses. Then we compare our estimates of tax revenue losses with the GDP, with the tax revenue in the country, with the government expenditure on healthcare and education, and with nurses' salaries. And we do this to get an idea of how big the tax revenue losses are as a function of the size of the country. So I'm going to talk about the corporate tax abuse, and then Miroslav will talk about the private tax abuse. So we start with data coming from the country-by-country reporting from the OECD, and then we create a model on top of this to estimate missing data. So for example, Germany doesn't report data to the OECD or doesn't publish it. And our method consists of measuring profit misalignment. So we compare the location of the profits of multinationals with the location of the economic activity. This is sales, employees, and wages. If in a specific country there are too many profits booked in relationship to the economic activity, we estimate that profits have been shifted into that country. Then we take this figure of profit shifting and then multiply it by the effective tax rate of the country to estimate the tax revenue losses. And now our results show that the profit shifting worldwide is $1.3 trillion, while the tax revenue losses are $245 billion. And this is consistent with the aggregated estimates of the OECD that are around $240 billion. And in the next slide, I'm going to give you a small overview or a small, I'm going to walk you through an example just to give a better feeling of the methodology. So here is the part of the data of India, and we have Indian multinationals, US multinationals, and Bermudian multinationals. And these companies report in India, Indian multinationals report in India $69 billion, US multinationals report in India $12 billion, and Bermudian multinationals report in India $34 million. When you compare these profits to the global profits in the entire world, you get that Indian multinationals report 1.3% of global profits in India, US multinationals 0.22%, Mermodian multinational 0.0006%. Then we look at the share of economic activities reported in India, which is 1.5% for India multinationals, 0.3% for US multinationals, and 0.01% for Bermudian multinationals. The difference between these numbers is the misalignment. So India multinationals have 14% too few profits reported in India compared with the economic activity. US multinationals have 37% too little profits compared with the economic activity. And Bermudian multinationals have 94% too few profits compared with the economic activity. Then we can multiply this misalignment by the total profits to get the profit shifting. In the case of India multinationals in India, they shift 12 billion out of the country. US multinationals shift 6.9 billion out of the country. And Bermudian multinationals shift 500 million out of the country. Then we do this for all the different multinationals of the different countries in India, and then we get to a global total for the case of India. And then we do this for every country in the world. And now I'm gonna pass the slides to my colleague Miroslav to talk about private tax abuse.
Right, thank you. So the second part of estimates, or second sets of estimates that we do in the State of Tax Justice 2020 is on private tax abuse. And the methodology that we use relies on data from on cross-border bank deposits, which come from the Bank for International Settlements. And we use that data as a proxy for all offshore financial wealth. Offshore financial wealth is not only bank deposits, but also securities, bonds, and so on, which, however, is not covered by comparably reliable data. And so we use the recent data from the Bank for International Settlements as a proxy for all of the financial wealth. What we do in our approach is that we identify the origin of the bank deposits that are stored in secrecy jurisdictions around the world. And this methodology broadly follows the ones published recently in academic literature. And in the first step, we estimate what we call abnormal deposits. We do that by running a regression analysis on good countries, which basically is non-secretive countries. To illustrate how it works, this graph shows the relationship between GDP and inward bank deposits in each country. So all the yellow countries are countries in which the ratio between these two variables, between the GDP and the inward bank deposits, is not relatively high, whereas in the green countries this ratio is very high. At the same time, the green countries are those that offer secrecy opportunities for residents of other countries to hide their identity. And so we use all the yellow countries to estimate kind of a predicted value of inward bank deposits based on the size of the jurisdiction's economy. Then in the second step, we then subtract the actual observed inward bank deposits from the predicted value based on the GDP, and the difference between these two is the abnormal deposits. Now, so that was the first step. In the second step, we assign these abnormal deposits to the countries from which these deposits come to derive the distribution of offshore wealth. So for example, a finding from the second step is that Germans own 4.4% of the global total of abnormal deposits. In the third step, we apply this distribution to the total offshore financial wealth, which is estimated to be 11.6% of global GDP. So that translates into $10.6 trillion in 2018. And the finding from the third step is that Germans own around $474 billion in offshore financial wealth that is stored in secrecy jurisdictions. Then in the last step, we use this estimate to derive the tax revenue losses that are connected to it. And we ask basically how much would countries collect if they had taxed the returns on this wealth. We assume a 5% return on the investment in offshore wealth. And we use the top bracket personal income tax rate to derive the tax revenue losses. So a finding out of this would be that, for example, Germany loses $10.6 billion on tax revenue, which represents 1.2% of its current tax revenues. So that's, in a nutshell, the methodology of the two approaches. Now I'm going to tell you a little bit about how to access the data that we produce in the report. So there is four ways to access that data. The first is that there are country level tables directly in the report. So you can see within the PDF of the report, you can see tables with estimates at the country level. The second way is that we have country reports. So for each country, we produce a report which summarizes all of the estimates that we produce. They are both online and downloadable as in a PDF format. We also have regional summaries where we aggregate these results across regions. We have those online and also in the report. And the fourth way is to access the complete data online, which is including also external estimates, not just ours, but also the ones that are existing and are trying to estimate the same issue. Currently, you can download those as Excel files from the SOTJ website. We have two files. The first one is a country file where we provide information at the country level. The second is a regional file where we provide the breakdowns by different country groups. In December, we will be launching a new TJM data portal, which will also offer a data explorer where you can also visualize the data and download whichever variables you want for your analysis. Now, just to show you briefly the country reports and regional summaries, the left part of the slide is what you will see on the website, where a country summary will provide an overview of all the estimates that we provide in the report. The ones on the right are the PDF reports for a country. So this is an example of Czechia, where again, we provide all the numbers from different chapters of the report. And the one on the right is an example of the regional summary. Okay, thank you very much. If you have any questions, feel free to ask or write us an email. Thank you.
Thank you, Javier and Miroslav. We are now going to hear from Liz Nelson, who is the Director of Tax Justice and Human Rights at the Tax Justice Network. And she's going to discuss with us how tax and health inequalities are connected and also touch on the gender and intersectional component. So Liz, the floor is now yours.
Thank you, Nana. I want to begin really because we're a little bit short of time and want to give more time for questions. So I want to begin with my conclusion. Our health is fundamental, is a fundamental human right. And progressive tax is the most sustainable way for us to achieve that right. And the realization of the right to health must be achieved without exacerbating existing structural and systemic inequalities. And as such, governments in particular, and through the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, and within the Sustainable Development Goals, which I'm sure many of you know about, governments have committed that the right to health be delivered to the maximum of its available resources with a view to achieving progressively its full realization. And crucially, without discrimination of any kind. So the transparency and availability of data, which is very much at the center of the State of Tax Justice report, is central to achieving the right to health. Our collective research and advocacy and our sure-footedness in consistently understanding the impact of policy reform and interventions is critical to ensuring we do not harm and that we reprogram our tax systems so that they run on equality. Now, the estimate of $427 billion tax abuse by multinational companies and health wealthy individuals, which is set out in the report, is thrown into really sharp relief, and others have mentioned this, when it's framed by the nurses' salaries metric, globally equivalent of nearly 34 million nurses' annual salaries is lost to tax havens each year. In Brazil, for instance, the tax revenue lost equates to over 2 million nurses' annual salary, And the impact of COVID-19 pandemic in Brazil has been exacerbated by a long-term underinvestment in public services. And this underinvestment undermines social and economic rights and particularly the well-being of women and girls. And the failure to provide an adequate and immediate budget to fight COVID-19 pandemic has meant that health professionals in Brazil, 65% of them whom are women, have suffered a lack of individual protection equipment. And this has exposed Brazil as one of the countries with the most deaths amongst health professionals. Among nurses, 85% women, Brazil has seen more deaths than any other country. Now, many of us know about the body of analysis that recognises the disproportionate deaths from the coronavirus among poorer and marginalised groups. In the global north, the virus has exposed the extent of structural racism. Black people in the global north tend to work in more exposed sectors. They tend to be less able to benefit from working remotely. They tend to have less wealth and hence less financial flexibility. And they also tend to suffer disproportionately from a range of underlying health conditions. There's the same systemic disregard for people with disabilities and for people living in care settings. The cost to principal carers, often women and girls, whether in formal settings or informally within households, has been just as significant. The burdens have also been unequal in countries in the global south, as we've heard, between rural and urban areas, between Black, minority, ethnic and indigenous people, and their white counterpart communities. And women in particular, whose rights and needs are often so chronically subordinated, are required to shoulder additional responsibilities of childcare, of other care duties, and to lose income as a result, or to rely on precarious jobs with no or few labour rights. This combination of factors is a grim story, and one which the State of Tax Justice report sets out. It's a story of greed over misery, of needless hardship, of private self-interest over public interest. And those countries with the greatest need for additional tax revenues to fund public health spending are precisely the countries that suffer worse losses to international tax abuse. But nearly all countries lose out to tax abuse. And as the pandemic has shown, all countries need greater resources to protect public health. The report spells out that some of these factors is that tax abuse is denying people the right to health and holding us all back from building back better, from healthier societies that achieve substantive equality. Thank you, Nana.
Liz, thank you so much for that overview. Now we will have a really important look at the impact of illicit financial flows and corporate tax avoidance in different regions of the world. So you'll be hearing from members and affiliates from the Global Alliance for Tax Justice, as well as Public Services International. And they have recorded some comments about what their reality is looking like on the ground. So let's turn to that video.
Some of the biggest challenges that we find ourselves facing on the African continent is the fact that we have some of the richest and wealthiest countries in the whole world in terms of mineral resources, in terms of human capital. But we find a lot of this wealth is not translating into meaningful benefits for the people on the street. Because of that, we find ourselves having some of the largest numbers of poverty and some of the largest numbers of inequality. One of the drivers of this is that we have large corporates, particularly multinational companies, that are moving the resources from their companies, from their countries of operations, to secret jurisdictions and to tax havens. As a result, the tax authorities are unable to garner the tax that they need to invest into key social sectors that are required to improve the livelihoods. Part of the reason we see this trend across our continent is because we have a number of issues. Firstly, we have corruption, which is rampant across the continent. We also have lack of governance, which is resulting in tax avoidance and tax evasion. We also see a lack of accountability and transparency, and all of this contributing to the way in which MNCs are able to manipulate the systems within our countries to therefore move and shift their profits and revenues. As a Tax Justice Network Africa, feel that if we were able to tackle these illicit financial flows, we would be able to contribute meaningfully to the positive development and growth of our continent.
The COVID-19 pandemic has hit all countries in the Asia-Pacific region. However, the impacts have been hardest on developing countries, the impoverished, and those experiencing discrimination and marginalization. Governments will need to raise resources to avoid lengthy economic recession, improve public health systems, and support workers who have lost employment. However, across Asia, countries are being denied billions of dollars in revenue from corporate tax avoidance. Corporations are known to engage in various forms of tax dodging, resulting in billions of dollars in revenues lost. Harmful and wasteful corporate tax incentives proliferate and promote a race to the bottom, damaging to all developing countries. Among the most highly incentivized are mining firms that plunder our resources, and companies in export processing zones that violate international labor standards. Our vulnerabilities to crisis could have been mitigated, or at least weathered with much less suffering, if revenues have been collected and invested in strengthening public social services. We would have been better prepared to meet the crisis without depending on borrowings and aid had our governments prudently defended taxpayers' money and ensured that revenues are equitably collected and that loopholes in tax policies are not abused. Tax and Fiscal Justice Asia, one of the regional members of the Global Alliance for Tax Justice, continues to call for safeguarding and mobilizing revenues to strengthen essential public services and to fulfill people's human rights, while ensuring that the poor are not burdened by unjust and regressive taxes. Furthermore, we call to stop the impunity of corporations engaging in illicit financial flows and the bleeding of our financial resources.
Workers in the Caribbean are mentally and physically fatigued from COVID-19. The health workforce is dealing with outbreaks of dengue fever, and also treating those who are burdened with the non-communicable diseases and other diseases. So it's not just a COVID-19 situation that they're facing. And teachers and their support staff are also trying their best to cope. And contrary to what we are hearing, there are not enough workers to deliver these vital public services. There are in fact chronic shortages all throughout the health, social and care services, as well as in the education and training sectors. And we really can't forget that these resources will be needed if we're talking about achieving the SDGs by 2030. And especially in the case of the Caribbean, we need resources to help fulfill the commitments made under the Paris Agreement. Our national treasuries need money. They need the money to invest in health and care services, education and training, various forms of social protection, and of course, the critical public services to which I previously referred. This money comes from public funding. But global tax abuse is the fly in the ointment. A tax system established decades upon decades ago is just not fit for purpose in this 21st century. And the reports of multinationals and the wealthiest among us avoiding and evading taxes are growing and increasing. There's also been a big shift to even more regressive tax systems. In the instance, shift from direct to indirect taxes. So some cases you find that workers, regular everyday Jennifers and Joes, are paying more taxes than their corporate directors or owners of businesses. If states really want to build back better and build resilience, then they will need to invest in critical and vital public services. To do so means taking giant steps, and they must boldly move forward towards tax transparency. In other words, we need and we must put people before profit.
All right. And today we are honored to be joined by two very distinguished panelists who will, who will provide insights on the implications of these findings. So first up, we are very pleased to welcome Professor Jayati Ghosh, who is a development economist from India and a commissioner for the Independent Commission for the Reform of International Corporate Taxation, or ICRICT. So Professor Ghosh, thank you so much for joining us today. And the floor is now yours.
Thank you so much, Nana. It's really a pleasure to be part of this and to be part of introducing this report. I cannot stress enough how important this report is. I should also just say how happy I am to be on this panel with Mercedes Marco del Ponte. I'm a huge admirer of everything that she has done for public policy and economic policy in Argentina. So, you know, this report is so utterly important because it is the first one that is actually based on the OECD's country by country reporting data, which has came out just in June, I think. So I really have to congratulate the network for doing such a good job of producing this very quickly. And of course, the methodology has already been explained to you very clearly. But what is really important to note about this methodology, it is very open, transparent, clear. It tells you exactly how they're measuring it. They're saying, well, these are the profits that should have been part of this country, essentially because of the employment, the sales, and criteria of that country. And yet what they're reporting is much less because they're transferring a lot of it out, claiming that it's because of intellectual property or various other license fees, all kinds of subterfuges which are available to them because of the way in which we have structured our global tax systems and because they're multinational companies. Now, when you do that, you do it very carefully using the country by country reporting of the companies, which they have done in an extraordinarily systematic and excellent way. You discover these incredible numbers, which they have revealed already, and I'm not going to bore you further. But just to tell you, you know, here we are fighting for an SDR release of $500 billion, which has not been, still been blocked by the IMF. We're doing everything possible to somehow generate that money. We are losing around that amount through this kind of tax, in tax revenues. So what are we saying? We are saying that you're losing at least half of that amount, $245 billion per year the world is losing in tax revenues, because companies are able and wealthy individuals are able to shift their money around in ways that allow them legally to avoid taxes. Two things I want to emphasize here. It's legal. It's not illegal. It's not evasion. It's not a crime. What they're doing is perfectly legal, and it's because we have created these loopholes that allow them to do it. And the second thing is that this is an underestimate. They make it very clear. We are estimating only the direct losses. The IMF has estimated that the indirect losses are usually around three times those of the direct losses. That is what governments then do to try and keep whatever, you know, to try and attract capital and provide other incentives and so on. So we are talking about global tax losses, direct and indirect, of nearly $1 trillion, $980 billion approximately. The other good thing this report has done is to highlight how much more this is just in relation to health expenditure. Why? Because the pandemic has revealed, and you saw from all of those videos, how important health expenditure is, how much we're losing. They find that in many African countries, the tax losses are more than double the amount that you are getting, that you're spending on health. Even in a country like India, the tax loss is nearly half of what you're spending on health in the public domain. This is ridiculous, okay? And of course, what is so important is not that, oh, well, what to do, they're using the loopholes in the system. The idea is to plug the loopholes. That's why the idea of unitary taxation is so important. This is what the independent commission, of which I'm a member, has been pushing, which is basically to say, treat the multinational company as one global company, which is how it behaves, and say, we will tax our share of your global profits according to a minimum tax rate. We have suggested 25%, which is a kind of average of the global tax rates. And we say, we will tax our share of your profits, which is determined by sales, employment, users, and so on, some formula. And we will charge you at that minimum rate. So you will be paying the same rate as domestic companies instead of being able to move it around. I noticed that there have been a lot of questions of how we do this without a global agreement, and how can we even get a global agreement if the US blocks it? Certainly the Trump regime has blocked it so far, and we're not sure how a future government will respond to this, given the fact that the next president is from Delaware, which is a known global tax haven. I should also mention that this report highlights that 55% of the tax havens avoidance comes from just this nexus of the United Kingdom, Netherlands, Luxembourg, and Switzerland. And if you add some of the states of the US, the dominant tax havens in the world are in the developed countries. How do we fight this? Well, you know, it's certainly we want an international agreement. The OECD initiative hasn't gone very far, but at least it has enabled country by country reporting for some countries, which is already what has given us this report. But in the face of this kind of obstruction, what do we do? I would argue this is the time now for unilateral action by countries, developed and developing. Go ahead and say we're going to tax Apple, Google, whoever, Netflix, I mean, whichever company there is, we're going to tax Amazon. We're going to tax you on our share of your global profits based on sales, employment, users. And if you do that, I mean, they're not going to say we're leaving your country. They cannot and will not. So this will force other governments to respond. It will force more negotiations. Unitary taxation is a very simple idea. The United States does it for its states. Canada does it for its provinces. It is something that can be done. We should actually insist that even if you do not get an international agreement, our governments go ahead and start doing this, because this will actually force a global negotiation. I think this report has shown very clearly the urgency of this and the need for this, and has brought out very scientifically how much we're losing. So I think this is a very, very important step in the global fight for tax justice. And I'm really proud of the people who produced this report. Thanks.
Great. Professor Ghosh, thank you again for those really excellent remarks. Next up, we are also very pleased to be joined by Senora Mercedes Marco del Pont, who is head of the Federal Administration of Public Revenues in Argentina, and previously was the president of the Central Bank of Argentina. Now, I just want to note that for this portion of the presentation, Senora Marco del Pont will be delivering her remarks in Spanish. So for those who do not wish to listen to her remarks in Spanish, you will have to select the interpretation button at the bottom of the screen and switch over to the English channel, because her translation will be broadcast through that channel. So, Senora Marco del Pont, thank you so much for joining us, and the floor is now yours.
Thank you very much. Bueno, muchas gracias. Buenos días acá desde la Argentina. Es para mí un placer estar participando en esta reunión. Quiero comulgo con el cariño y el respeto hacia Yayati Ghosh, con la que hemos compartido otras grandes discusiones acerca de esta etapa del capitalismo tan compleja de financiarización y que tiene como una de sus manifestaciones, como una de sus caras, este proceso de erosión de las bases imponibles y de la capacidad que tenemos los estados nacionales de desenvolver políticas públicas. Yo tengo ahora el honor de estar al frente de la Administración Federal de Ingresos Públicos de la Argentina en el contexto de un proyecto político muy distinto, que ha recuperado la decisión política de la soberanía en todos los frentes, en el frente externo, con la reestructuración de la deuda, con esta reestructuración de la deuda que estamos llevando a cabo con el Fondo Monetario Internacional, pero también en lo que hace a la recuperación de la soberanía fiscal. Yo agradezco además y valoro mucho el informe, que además me ha servido de insumo en discusiones públicas que hemos tenido en las últimas semanas en Argentina, porque nosotros hablaban de la necesidad de tener políticas proactivas, y nosotros hemos venido desempeñando en este año tan difícil políticas muy proactivas. Ya desde diciembre del año pasado, cuando este gobierno se hace cargo, nosotros desandamos mucho de lo que fue la política tributaria del gobierno anterior, que la reforma tributaria del gobierno anterior, que fue muy regresiva y que redujo enormemente los impuestos directos y los impuestos hacia los sectores de mayor capacidad contributiva. Esta semana, el Congreso de la Nación, la Cámara de Diputados, dio media sanción a un proyecto de ley que grava las fortunas, las grandes fortunas, en cabeza de las personas físicas de la Argentina, y con una base imponible muy amplia que recae sobre el 1% de los contribuyentes y que en principio nos permitiría recaudar aproximadamente 3.000 millones de dólares. Para nosotros es un avance importante, costó mucho, hay una discusión ardua, y la verdad que yo he usado como insumo en la discusión gran parte de la información que surge del trabajo tan riguroso y consistente que ha hecho Tax Justice Network. Este impuesto a las grandes fortunas es una realidad, porque yo sé que hay a nivel global se están discutiendo muchas de estas iniciativas, y bueno, nosotros aspiramos que la semana que viene probablemente este proyecto sea ley. Recalcar también que nosotros este año hemos, de la Argentina, hemos hecho un esfuerzo enorme en términos de expansión del gasto público orientado a todo lo que es la cobertura de la pandemia. Hemos aumentado en más de 6 puntos lo que es la asistencia a, más de 6 puntos del Producto Bruto Interno, la asistencia a no solamente a los sectores de la salud, sino también a los sectores al sector privado, a las empresas. Hemos pagado salarios de más de 2.400.000 trabajadores, la mitad de los salarios de más de 2.400.000 trabajadores. Hemos dado créditos subsidiados, hemos hecho transferencias directas de ingreso a los sectores de la informalidad, o sea que ha sido un esfuerzo muy grande por parte del Estado argentino, que fue financiado fundamentalmente intrasector público, digamos, con financiamiento del Banco Central. En este contexto tan difícil, la gestión de la AFIP, mi gestión, a partir de comulgar con el diagnóstico que se ha hecho a lo largo de este encuentro y que ustedes han venido militando desde hace tanto tiempo, hemos planteado un esfuerzo muy, muy grande para que la gestión se focalice en mejorar la capacidad de fiscalización y de recaudación en los sectores de mayor capacidad contributiva. O sea, otorgarle a todo lo que es la política de administración tributaria un sesgo progresivo que tenga que ver con captar mayores recursos de los sectores con mayor capacidad contributiva. Y en ese sentido ya hemos logrado cambios en lo que es la composición este año de la estructura tributaria, de los ingresos tributarios, en un contexto, repito, muy difícil, donde nuestra economía estimamos que este año va a caer en torno al 10%. Una de las cosas que hemos impulsado y que va totalmente en línea con lo que es el contenido de este documento es el área de fiscalidad internacional. Advertimos efectivamente que en nuestro país ha habido una enorme deficiencia en el enforcement y la capacidad que tiene el Estado para abordar esta problemática de la fiscalidad internacional, y en ese sentido hemos tomado decisiones muy específicas, hemos sacado regulaciones puntuales que tienen que ver con pedirle a las empresas que nos presenten obligatoriamente su planificación fiscal todos los años para conocer cuáles son los mecanismos, como bien planteaba Yayati, legales para pagar menos impuestos. Conocerlos a priori y nosotros estar en condiciones de desenvolver una mejor fiscalización de esas empresas, de esos grupos económicos, de esas personas físicas. También hemos incorporado todo un régimen muy exhaustivo para conocer la información sobre precios de transferencia que le estamos pidiendo a las empresas multinacionales. También impulsamos una nueva regulación para conocer, para que las empresas informen cuáles son los beneficiarios finales de de todas las estructuras que se arman en términos de trust, de fideicomisos, para conocerse, generar la trazabilidad necesaria a la hora de desenvolver nuestra política de fiscalización. Estamos trabajando, porque creo que eso surge claramente del documento, pero también de toda la evaluación que se está haciendo de este año tan, tan difícil de la pandemia, y dónde, cuáles han sido los ganadores y los perdedores, y qué pasa con todo, con la concentración y la enorme rentabilidad que han tenido todos los sectores de la economía, digital. Y nosotros estamos muy atrasados en esa materia. Estamos participando activamente en los pilares 1 y 2 del marco de inclusión de la OCDE, pero también estamos avanzando con proyectos de ley que aspiramos que se puedan implementando en los próximos meses, asociados a ver cómo podemos grabar en materia de ganancias a las plataformas, a todo lo que es el esquema de la economía digital. Como bien se planteó a lo largo de esta charla, somos conscientes de que los espacios que tenemos los estados nacionales para avanzar con eficacia en el abordaje de estos problemas tiene sus límites si no se logra este marco de cooperación, de coordinación, de intercambio de información a nivel global, y por eso es que nosotros estamos a disposición para trabajar en conjunto y para seguir impulsando todos los ámbitos de discusión, de intercambio y sobre todo de concientización, que es un trabajo fantástico que hace la Just Tax Justice Network, para generar esa conciencia acerca de las consecuencias y las implicancias tan regresivas que está generando este comportamiento del capital a nivel global. Bueno, gracias.
Señora Merkel de Pont, thank you so much for those excellent remarks. And Professor Ghosh, thank you again for your remarks as well. Now it is time for some Q&A, and Professor Ghosh, Señora Merkel de Pont, and Alex Cobham will be fielding your questions. So please continue to share them in the chat below so we can discuss, but we'll go ahead and start with a few questions that have already been posed within the Q&A. All right, so the first question, has the 2015 OECD BEPS program improved the situation in any way?
Do you want us to answer, Nana, or should we collect questions?
I figured that we could that you could answer. I'll throw out the questions and then we can answer them one by one.
Oh, okay. Yes. Who goes first? You have to guide us, Nana.
Yes. All right, Professor Ghosh, I would love to hear your thoughts on that.
So I think the OECD BEPS process has been disappointing. It's been too slow. It hasn't been inclusive enough of developing countries who were basically let in to sit at the table after all the major decisions were made. And it finally has not resolved anything. In other words, what was finally proposed in November last year was very watered down. And the multinational lobbies managed to insert all kinds of nonsense, like making a distinction between routine and residual profits, which is meaningless. You never tax a company on what is a residual profit within a country. Why should you do it globally? The only positive outcome so far, I would say, is precisely this country-by-country reporting, which at the moment is only for OECD members. And I think Mercedes made a very good point about how this has to become something that is globally essential. But so far, I would say it has been a disappointment. And I really think that this calls for a move to a more international setting, that is the UN Tax Committee, which would be put on board the needs of developing countries much more explicitly.
Wonderful. Thank you for your thoughts. Now we will move on to a question about obstructive countries, particularly the United States. So the question was posed, I understand that the United States is the biggest tax haven. How can we reconcile this with the UN Tax Convention proposal, which deals with cross-border abuse only? Can we add instruments to try to deter behaviors of individual countries, even if they don't sign up? And then as a follow-up to that, the next president was a longtime senior senator for Delaware, the epicenter of U.S. involvement in offshoring. Do you think this will hinder or help a U.S. Role in the proposals that have been made here? And so Professor Ghosh, and then also Senora Merkel de Pont, I would love to hear your thoughts on this.
Maybe I let Mercedes respond first. And
nosotros, a ver, nosotros cuando llegamos acá a la AFIP, a la Administración Federal de Ingresos Públicos, encontramos que se había firmado un acuerdo, un convenio de intercambio de información en el marco de la OCDE. Es información que no había sido explotada, que tenía que ver con cuentas de argentinos, empresas y personas en el resto del mundo. Y la verdad es que empezamos a desencriptar esta información y estamos trabajando muy intensamente con ese acervo de datos. Va a llevar tiempo, pero creemos que es, nosotros tenemos además un caso muy particular que es el tema de Uruguay y de nuestro país vecino, donde hay muchos argentinos que tienen parte de su riqueza, de sus activos financieros, de todos sus activos en ese país. O sea que el primer avance tiene que ver con desencriptar la información respecto a Uruguay, pero tenemos un caudal enorme, enorme de información que estamos empezando a explotar. Quiero decir, es muy importante que en los países subdesarrollados como la Argentina, tener la vocación política de, por parte de las administraciones federales de ingresos públicos de avanzar en no solamente en el intercambio, sino en la coordinación y la articulación de toda la información que se produce dentro del sector público. Lo que yo vengo del Banco Central de la República Argentina, en un país bimonetario y dolarizado como es la República Argentina, en un país donde gran parte de la financiarización se produce a partir de la fuga de capitales, donde hay un caudal de información enorme en el Banco Central que no estaba siendo explotado por este organismo, y por lo tanto estamos en un trabajo de coordinación, no solamente y de explotación de información de la que viene de afuera, sino de la que también existe en distintos ámbitos del Estado Nacional. Me parece que esto es algo que también tenemos que discutir porque supone el fortalecimiento de toda la estructura estatal de una nación para en búsqueda de los mismos objetivos. Nosotros tenemos, manejamos la aduana también acá en la Administración Federal de Ingresos Públicos y también con la aduana estamos haciendo un trabajo muy, muy coordinado por el tema de la sobre y subfacturación y en última instancia de lo que pasa con el tema de precios de transferencia en el comercio internacional. Hemos generado ya un conjunto de sistemas de precios de referencia para los principales productos de exportación y de importación que nos están permitiendo tener mayores instrumentos para evaluar este problema grave en la economía argentina, que es el de la sobre y subfacturación de exportaciones y de importaciones.
Señora Merkel-Lapont, thank you. Now, Professor Ghosh, the floor is yours.
Thank you. You know, I think Mercedes just gave an excellent example of what countries can do on their own, even in a situation where you are faced with, as the people have said, global obstruction. And I want to emphasize, it's not obstruction by a country. It is obstruction by particular governments driven by corporate lobbies. And that's very different. It's not in the US people's interest to allow this kind of thing. So just as, you know, we want globally this tax reform, people and organizations and movements in the United States should be demanding this within the US as well, because they are the biggest losers. Citizens are losers when governments don't get tax revenue and they rely more on indirect taxation and so on. So I think what do we do in the face of that obstruction? We certainly mobilize people within the countries that have governments that are obstructing, and I reiterate that. We try and counter the lobbying pressure of companies with the lobbying pressure of people, if you like, and movements. And also, as I said before, you know, there is really scope for unilateral movements of other governments, which will force the resistant governments or the ones who are more amenable to corporate pressure to respond. So we don't have to say, well, so-and-so is necessarily inclined towards allowing tax avoidance because of his past history, Delaware or whatever. We have to say the pressures in the United States are such that they will have to close these loopholes, and we will make those pressures large enough. I think the same is true for us globally in countries where our governments stand around and tell us what can we do until the US and the European Union agree we can't do anything. That's not true. And I think we must now demand action on the part of all our governments, just as Mercedes has shown how it can be done in Argentina as well.
Wonderful. Now, the next question I will throw out to Alex. It's a pair of questions about a financial transactions tax, as well as climate taxes. So the first question is that a global financial transactions tax was not included in the State of Tax Justice 2020 recommendations. And do the researchers believe this is achievable or worth pursuing? And then the second question is asks why this webinar has only linked tax justice to COVID-19, because possibly even more money is required to combat the climate emergency, to stop droughts and floods and hurricanes, as well as sea level rise in the global south and elsewhere. And our commentator mentioned that there is a need for new taxes like carbon taxes that steer low carbon development. So we'd be very happy to hear your thoughts on those questions.
Thanks, Nana. These are great questions. And, you know, it's kind of a nice illustration of how important tax is. We're not just talking about raising revenues, but also changing behaviours. And, you know, on the previous point, actually building political representation, because of course tax does that. And one of the problems with the United States government is how tax has been undermined, and at the same time, political representation. But on these two questions, this report is really about the lost revenues from current taxes. It's the money that ought to be coming to governments at the moment to spend on public services like health and so on. These two proposals, you know, in terms of the behavioural change that you could get from the right sort of climate taxes and from the right type of financial transactions taxes, these are definitely things that, you know, I think all our movements have supported over time. The Tax Justice Network is actually bringing forward a kind of a new program of work around climate, and we have a conference on this in December, so that might be of interest. But I think in general, it's definitely within the scope, just that in this particular report, what we're focused on is the revenue losses, what's currently being lost. So definitely part of the tax discussion, just not right in the center of this particular report.
Alex, thank you for those remarks. Now, we just have to mention that Senora Merkel Del Pont has to leave us. She has another obligation, but I just wanted to thank her again for her excellent remarks and all of her insights. So thank you again for your time and for illuminating how important this issue is for Argentina and for governments around the world. Thank you again.
Muchas gracias a ustedes. Muchas gracias por la invitación. Muy honrada por la invitación. Bueno, y a disposición para seguir trabajando.
Well, thank you. We look forward to what you will accomplish.
Okay, right. Bye-bye.
Take care. All right. Now, moving back to the Q&A, I have a question for Professor Ghosh. Also, Alex, if you'd like to weigh in. How can we use the report's findings to strengthen the case that secrecy jurisdictions are violating human rights beyond their borders, i.e. breaching their extraterritorial obligations?
Well, I think the report puts it actually very clearly. It is highlighting how much individual countries are losing in, as I said, in the underestimated case based on particular companies' accounts, how much they're losing to corporate taxation, how much they're losing because wealthy, very high net worth individuals are shifting their money out. That's huge. And if in each country you can actually take that amount and compare it to essential spending like health, but also a huge range of other essential spending. People have mentioned climate investments and so on as well, that needs to be done. You realize how much this is actually impacting on the basic rights of citizens. Now, from there to demand that these secrecy jurisdictions, or sometimes they're not even secret, these low tax jurisdictions are impinging on the human rights of others. I think a very big contribution of this report is to say not only how much tax is being lost in each country, but how much a particular country is contributing to tax losses of others. And that's a really big thing that can be used politically in a very significant way. It can be used in multilateral negotiations. I think that's a very important contribution of this report. I should have mentioned it earlier, but I'm glad it's come up. And somebody, I think there was a question about Europe. What do European countries do about, you know, the bad guys in Europe, basically Ireland, Netherlands, Switzerland, and so on. Same thing. Use these data to say, listen, how dare you? It's not just being a bad neighbor. You are actively obstructing us from meeting the needs of our own citizens, and you have no right to do that. In other words, I think this can be a fantastic lobbying tool because it has very clear data that has been put together in a very systematic and scientific way. And so I think this, you know, this is going to open the doors for a lot more very active mobilization around this.
Thank you for that, Professor Ghosh. Okay, last question, we'll pose this to Alex. Is there any relationship between the calculations shared in this report and those of known inequality economist Gabriel Zucman?
Yes, well, yes and no. So I shouldn't cast any shade on Professor Zucman, but you know, his work is among the work that we drew on in putting together, in fact, both methodologies, because he has worked on corporate as well as individual tax abuse. What we plan to do in December, we'll publish a data portal, which will include not only all the estimates that we published today, but also lots of the other estimates, including some of Professor Zucman and others, to allow people to compare what the numbers look like both globally and for individual countries where there's coverage. None of those individual existing estimates has the same type of global coverage that we've managed with this report, but often you can see particular overlaps in countries, and it's interesting to think about why they're different. As Dereje mentioned earlier, on the corporate side, for example, our data only cover the very biggest multinationals, so there are some broader estimates that show the scale of the problem being even larger, and that's interesting to compare across countries. So this, I think there's an interesting moment now in terms of methodologies. quite a few different methodologies using the same data broadly now in the same space. And you know, we know there's a set of research papers from various people coming out over the next 6 months or so, and we'll see how all of these line up. But it feels very much like a moment that's quite a strong consensus in the academic and policy research around a set of numbers roughly of this sort of scale. And I think, you know, going back to Professor Ghosh's point, that's you know, really going to help to drive the accountability for individual governments around the role they're playing, not just in fighting the losses they face themselves or that their people face in effect, but also addressing the losses that they're imposing on other countries. And that's, you know, if there's one thing we hope to come out of this report, it will be the strengthening of the movement globally in our ability together to hold individual governments to account. So let's see.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Alex. And I just want to extend a very warm thank you to Professor Ghosh again for accepting our invite and providing such wonderful and insightful remarks on what this report means for tax justice globally. So
I just want to say congratulations and thank you for producing this report, Alex and everybody else at Tax Justice Network. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so now we are about to close today's event, but before we do so, I'll hand over the floor to Alex, who will make some final closing remarks.
Thank you. And very briefly, I want to thank all the panelists and speakers and Nana, you for moderating and making this whole thing hang together so well. We can't thank you enough for that. I also have to thank again Public Services International and the Global Alliance for Tax Justice, our partners in this work, who've just been, you know, brilliant in both working with us on the content, but also taking it out to regional and national partners and affiliates, who in turn have done a fantastic job picking up what is often quite difficult material and fitting it in their national context, working with media, starting to raise questions with policymakers and with the wider public. And we really hope this is the beginning of, as I say, a very powerful movement in that space. But I have to thank also our funders, first and foremost of whom is FES, the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung, who are both financial partners, but also intellectual partners in this project. I can't think of another funder who gets it the way that FES does, and we're very grateful for their support in this. NORAD also, who have funded a lot of the technical work behind different bits of this data that we brought together, and the European Commission, who supported work on the indexes that are also part of the analysis here. I urge you to go and look at the country profiles and find the data on the vulnerability in the index rankings, as well as the revenue losses. Within the Tax Justice Network, I can't name all the individuals who have helped, but everyone who has worked on the network building, the communications and media, the data, the quantitative analysis and research, the logistics and the operations. This has been by a mile the biggest thing that we have brought together, and I'm extremely proud of how well the whole team has worked on that. As I say, the most important thing though with this work isn't the numbers, isn't the analysis. It is where it goes from here. It is the political change that we can make happen. And so everyone who has joined this webinar and may watch it later, I want to thank you, because it's what you do now that will make that difference to how far this travels, how far we are able to drive improvements in the state of tax justice. So I look forward to hearing more thoughts and comments on this work this year, and to seeing you all again for the State of Tax Justice 2021, which is not so far away either. And on that, thank you.